Hello, everyone, and welcome to this webinar on the 3Q mentoring program.
Hello, everyone. Welcome. As you know, this mentoring program is for our attendees of our online courses. And it's meant to support you with any questions that you might have and obstacles that you would encounter in your practice.
That's right. So we've got some questions from some of you already, which we're going to address today on this session. And if you have any other questions while you're listening, please send them into the chat box, and we'll attempt to, we will answer all questions. We may not have time to answer them all today, but they'll get answered either today or on some subsequent occasion, or by email. So before we begin, let's do the 3Q portal together. And
just wanted to welcome Adrian. I see he's here with us now.
Yeah, welcome everyone to the 3Q mentoring program. As you know, you can send us questions in the chat box while the session continues. So let's just refresh ourselves with the portal. As you all know, the portal is about going from the object pole of attention as the ego to the subject pole of attention as the soul. And that, of course, is what activates your spiritual intelligence. And these three steps that you all know so well are what make this massive transformation in a split second, right? Isn't it amazing? You know how on Star Trek, the spacecraft goes from normal speed to warp speed? Suddenly it's going, at light speed, and, galaxies are flying by the window. The 3Q portal's a bit like that. It's like you're going warp speed, because just imagine the transformation that's happening, right? You're going from presuming to be this separate body-mind to experiencing the truth that you are consciousness itself. And this is a shift to a whole different universe, isn't it? Because in one instant, you change who you are, you change your view about reality, you change your perception of what's important, you change your feelings about the nature of your life, you change your perception of your future, you change your perception of your past, and you change your life destiny in a split second. I mean, pretty amazing, isn't it? So this is a Star Trek journey into the into the other dimension, right? These three steps. Now, you could say, yes, but all meditation's like that. Well, that's true. But as you know, traditional forms of meditation can take quite a while, 20 minutes, half an hour, before you get to a new identity. And in fact, many traditional forms don't actually get you there. Often you just stay at the object pole, fighting your thoughts the whole time, right? So this is a very massive transformation in a very short space of time. That's why the reason I'm discussing it is just so we can appreciate how useful this portal to another dimension, how useful it is. So let's do it together. Step one, notice that attention has two poles. What you're aware of at the object pole, and at the other pole, awareness itself. Step two, feel. So here's where we feel what it's like at the subject pole. So bring your attention to your breathing. Just notice at the end of the in-breath, there's a slight pause when you're neither breathing in or breathing out. And feel what it's like in that pause. Now, when you feel that peacefulness there, you'll find your body relaxes And that means it's time to move to step three. Be that peaceful feeling. Let your eyes open now, just have a look around. Just confirm for yourself that you're now being the field of awareness. Just notice how that feels. You're not being the body, you're not being the mind, you're not being your thoughts or emotions. They're all happening or not, but whatever's arising to attention, you're just the field of awareness within which that thing emerges, right? So this is a pleasurable state, isn't it? Because you're free of the implications of everything at the object pole, right? So it's actually quite a humorous state. Humor suddenly returns, right? You're not implicated by all that stuff. You're standing free of it prior to it as your true self, right? So just a point about the headband. As you know, some courses that we run use a headband, which gives you a readout on your phone of your brain activity. So we're not going to be discussing headband issues on the mentoring program because not all our courses use a headband. So if you have questions about the headband, please discuss those questions in the course that you're doing right now, which uses the headband. And we can answer any questions there. So, Bastianella, I know you've got some questions from emails that we've received. Perhaps you could help to read out the first one.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, it's from Adrian, actually, who's with us today. And I see that somebody else also stepped in, which is great. Okay, so the first question is, I see children that are so present and manifest conscience that I'm left without words. Or maybe in the process of becoming from children to adult, we just forget, like the second fall from Eden here on earth, from child to 3Q brain and to Eden again. So hope I'm not too abstract with this question, he says.
No, well, that's a good question. It's a good question because I think it's something that many people have observed, that children seem to have that spark of spiritual energy, you know, that most of us seem to lose as we get a bit older. And it's quite true that, you know, children have a much less solidified ego identification than adults, you know, young children have still not fully identified with the body and mind as who they are. In other words, they're still not fully committed egos. They still have a sense of, you know, a connection with what's beyond the body and mind. And you can often see that in kids when they're, you know, able to beam with such brightness when there's no apparent reason to be happy at all. They don't care. They're just happy, right? And when they skip down the street, when walking would perfectly suffice, but they prefer skipping because there's too much joy to contain, so they have to skip. You know what I'm saying? So, yeah, they're in connection with source more than adults, aren't they, children? Because as we grow, as we get a bit older, we take on this dreadful news that, oh, my God, I'm this body and mind. You know, you take on that presumption, and because it's reinforced by all these sources of education in the mainstream, you know, they're all telling you you're this body and mind. You know, after being told that 1,000 times by all the sources of information that you've ever come across, then you sort of, well, must be true then, right? Must be true. And so your committed ego, by the time you're seven, anything else that you'd previously felt beyond being the ego is pretty much lost. And so you're a fully paid up member of the ego population by then. And so, yeah, the sense of spiritual intelligence, that connection to source diminishes. And, you know, as you progress, then of course you inherit all the ills of the ego, one after another, until by the time you're a, you know, teenager or late teenager, you've had enough ego diet to feel depressed, suicidal, wondering what the point of it all is and why bother going on, you know. Seriously, right? And unfortunately, at that stage, adolescents are not given the help that they could get to understand themselves and go beyond that ego problem, right? In other words, schools don't yet teach spiritual intelligence or anything equivalent. And so progression moves on to, you know, the 20s and middle age and so on. And by then, you're firmly in the belief that you are the body and mind. And now, even though religions may come along to give you a sense of a greater destiny, nevertheless, religions are engaged from the point of view of the ego, right? It's only forms of spirituality which release you from ego identification. Religion actually just consoles the ego, whereas spirituality transcends ego identification, and this is why we, you know, teach the portal. So just in coming back to the question, yes, children do have this connection with Source, which we can see is a form of spiritual intelligence, and they gradually lose it, and so there needs to be a re-education later in life, teens preferably, when you can learn how you've lost connection with Source and learn a method of reconnecting. So on the question of, is it the second Eden? Was it the second, what was it, Bastianella, in the question? Was it the second Eden or the second baptism or the second, I can't remember the question. What did the questioner say?
It says, maybe in the process, from children to adulthood, we just forget, like the second fall from Eden.
Oh, the second fall from Eden, yeah. So really it's the first fall from Eden, you see, because the fall from Eden is the very process of going from being the soul, being connected to Source, to wrongly presuming I'm a body and mind. That fall into ego is the fall from Eden. That is the fall from Eden. So this is the first fall from Eden that happens as you get a bit older, you know, your early years, moving up to the age 7. That is the first fall from Eden, not the second. Because, you know, the religious idea of the fall from Eden is something that happened a long time ago, right? Or it happened before your birth. But no, the fall from Eden happens after you're born, when you move from that sense of connection with Source to this false idea of I'm a body and mind. That's the fall from Eden, the first fall from Eden, yeah. Was that at all to that question? Was anything you wanted to add to that, what was saying about that, Bastianella?
Well, I would just might add that when you're a child, you're not aware that you're connected to Source. You're aware of yourself as being the soul. Whereas when you start, right, developing your spiritual intelligence, then you are aware. You're doing that process in at will, right? Reconnecting to Source. So that would be a difference, if we can say that.
It is a difference, yeah. Because it's a difference between, you know, pre-conscious SQ and post-conscious SQ. You know, that, as you said, the child is not aware of being consciousness itself, of being the heart, of being connected to Source. The child's not aware, it's just doing it, right? So when you later, so when you lose that connection, go back and go into ego states, and then after that, discover the soul again through 3Q or through any other method that reconnects you to Source, that is different, as you're saying, Bastianella, because that is a recovery and that represents a recognition of the soul. And so you can only so having lost the soul connection, you can then recognize what it is. So you have to sort of lose it before you can recognize it, right? So soul realization is only possible after you've been an ego. Right. Whereas the child, it hasn't been an ego yet. hasn't been an ego yet. The child, the baby, you know, the young child who's still connected to source as pre-ego. And therefore the young child can't have soul realization because you can only have that post-ego, right?
Yeah. I just wanted to welcome Diana as well to our talk today. And Adrian, please let us know if this has answered your question in the chat box, please. And until then, we can handle the second question, if that's okay. He says, thank you. So probably the answer was complete. So the second question is, how do I know when I am being consciousness itself and not being the ego? Sometimes I can't tell.
Sometimes I can't tell the difference. Is that what it says?
Yeah.
Yeah. So let me ask you, Bastianella, how do you know when you're experiencing 3Q and as opposed to just being in the ego state? How do you know?
Yeah, well, you know, I have had this question myself in the beginning of my practice. I remember that. And because, you know, practicing the portal, sometimes it's clear, sometimes it's not. Having this habit of being the ego, this transition takes a while until you get clear about it. So in my experience now, it's very much clear when I'm not being the ego, because first of all, I'm not reactive. And I feel at peace and I feel present. I'm not, you know, stolen away from my true identity, from my thoughts and emotions. So when I am going away with my thoughts and emotions, I know I'm in the ego identity, right? When I'm being present and just witnessing those thoughts and emotions, I know I'm at the subject form, in this soul position. So that's how I know. I'm not reactive, and it's a sense of peace with it and being present.
Yes, and so other aspects of that difference is that when you're using your 3Q, you'll be aware that your heart is the senior impulse rather than your thinking mind. In other words, you'll be led by your heart in response rather than by your thinking process. Your thinking process will be in service to your heart impulse rather than the thinking process being primary as the means whereby you decide or feel moved to do this, that, or the other. So you'll be aware, when you're in 3Q, you'll be aware that it's whatever your heart is committed to which defines your priorities, not whatever whatever impulse may be there, which disconnected from your heart impulse, which of course is ego impulses. So you'll be aware of that, of love being the context of your connection with others, you know, and you'll be aware of coming from an impulse to want to serve and help other people, you know, as opposed to when you're in the ego state, what can I get out of this now, you know, which is a whole different orientation, right?
Yeah, that's so true. Yeah, I actually remember a time when I noticed that my awareness started to shift from, you know, living from the mind. And it shifted, it just came into the heart and everything became more warm, you know, relating to others, to situations, to everything. I was just more open. And yeah, this kind of equals, well, for me, it equals with being present. So when I say I'm being present, it means I am being present to my heart impulses. So,
Yeah, so I know you have some more questions there, Bastianella. Go on.
Okay, we have a great question from Adrian as well about mindfulness. And it says, as you know, I'm the new kid on the block. he's just started the practitioner course and still grasping the essentials. I have a question about mindfulness in parallel with soulfulness or the 3Q method. Do I feel correctly that the portal is very close if you access the mindfulness state completely, in fact, sometimes you get from mindfulness state to soulfulness, even though you are not using the 3Q portal, if you really do it right and complete. Is this true? Or how do you see this?
Yeah. There's a few points there to cover. Let's just start with understanding the basic difference between spiritual intelligence and mindfulness. And, you know, was that Adrian's question? Was it Bastianella?
Yes, he was. And he had some additions. He said, you explained and I understood the big part, but still this needs clarification so I can be sure. I'm trying to understand the way, not to say which or what is better. In fact, I'm here because for me, 3Q has the most sense.
Yeah, right. Okay, let's start off. I want to cover all those points. Let's start off with just a basic understanding of the difference between mindfulness and 3Q. So, mindfulness is basically a faculty of spiritual intelligence. So spiritual intelligence includes mindfulness and goes beyond it. So mindfulness can be summarized in the form of this sentence here: be aware of the contents of the mind without judgment. That summarizes the instruction that you need to follow in order to practice mindfulness, at least as it's taught in the West. I mean, there are differences in how it's taught in the original Buddhist context, but anyway, as it's taught in the West, this is how it is. Now, we need to understand a crucial distinction in order to know the difference between mindfulness and 3Q, and that's the difference between the observing ego and the witnessing soul. So let me just explain what I mean by the observing ego and the witnessing soul. The observing ego is aware of objects of attention, but without awareness of being the subject of attention, right? Simply aware of objects, but not aware of I'm the consciousness which is aware of these objects, right? Whereas the witnessing soul is aware of being the subject of attention, you know, aware of being consciousness itself, while attending to objects of attention. As consciousness itself, the witnessing soul has access to all the qualities and capabilities of the soul, unlike the observing ego. So let me just go back to that previous slide and just clarify then what this previous slide is saying. So when you're using mindfulness, typically you'll be using the observing ego. So you'll be at the object pole of attention, i.e. you'll still be assuming that I am this body and mind, and you'll be using part of your mind to focus on the rest of your mind. It's called being the observing ego. With 3Q, in contrast to mindfulness, you actually shift identity from ego to soul, and then you witness what's going on in the body-mind from the subject pole, and therefore have access to all the other qualities and capabilities of the soul, in addition to the ability to witness events at the object pole. So mostly when people practice mindfulness, which is, you know, when they follow the instruction to be aware of objects of attention without judgment, most of the time they remain at the object pole as the observing ego. However, it's perfectly possible that quite randomly people can drift to the subject pole while practicing mindfulness. And they can actually, as a result of that drift to the subject pole, they can actually become awareness itself and be awareness itself, even though that's not explicitly the practice that they've been taught to do. Because all they've been taught to do is simply be aware of objects without judgment. But as a result of following that instruction, they could move from being the observing ego quite spontaneously to becoming the witnessing soul. And how they would know they'd made that difference, that shift, would be if they're aware that I'm not assuming that I am this body and mind anymore. I am free of that assumption. I'm just observing the body and mind without identifying with it. So that can happen. That can happen. And therefore, in answer to the question, or one of the points in the question, yes, 3Q is close to mindfulness, or mindfulness is close to 3Q. And the way we distinguish it is by saying that mindfulness is a faculty of 3Q. Now there were some other questions in that. There were some other points in that question, Bastianella, that I've forgotten what they were. What were the other points raised in that question?
He said, do I feel correctly that the portal is very close if you access the mindfulness state completely?
Yes, so let's just stop there. Yeah, so if you access the mindfulness state completely. Now, I guess what you're meaning by the word completely is that if you use the mindfulness instruction, which is be aware of the contents of the mind without judgment, if you use that instruction and follow that instruction, then as a result, you could spontaneously and without intending to and quite by accident and, you know, go from the object pole to the subject pole. That's quite possible. Now, if you're meaning that that's equivalent to doing the mindfulness practice completely, if that's what you're meaning, well, the complete mindfulness practice is this: be aware of the contents of the mind without judgment. That is doing it completely. So doing mindfulness completely doesn't necessarily result in you going to the subject pole and being the soul, being awareness itself. It could happen, but it's not part of the practice. But it could happen. And maybe for many it does happen. It's quite possible. But if it does happen, then it's a byproduct of doing the practice of mindfulness. It's, yeah, it's an unintended byproduct. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Exactly. Whereas using the portal is going directly there at will. Right?
That's right. And intentionally. Intentionally. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. He says, observing ego and witnessing soul. Yes. Randomly. Yes. Understood. Thank you. Yes. Yes.
Okay, cool. That's great. Now, there's just another couple of points that we could go into, but maybe we can leave these points for another time. Perhaps just quickly go through these just while we're on the topic. So mindfulness, you know, when it works and if you follow the practice as recommended, you can do it quite easily. Observe what's happening without judgment. You know? So it does give you calm, clarity, and focus. So mindfulness does give you these good benefits: calm, clarity, and focus. No doubt about that. But if you practice 3Q and go beyond mindfulness, you could call it mindfulness from the subject pole, right? That's 3Q. You're being the witnessing soul. Then you get all the benefits of mindfulness plus the benefits of all the other faculties of 3Q, like, the qualities of the soul, like wisdom, compassion, joy, love, you know, and the capabilities of the soul, you know, egoless perception, egoless motives, and so on. So you get a whole lot more value, a whole bigger transformation if you use mindfulness from the subject pole rather than mindfulness from the object pole. In other words, using the witnessing soul, not the observing ego, which is equivalent to using 3Q. So another way to describe the difference is that mindfulness is be aware as the ego of the contents of the mind without judgment, whereas 3Q is be aware as the soul of the content of the mind without judgment. So that's a pretty big difference, right? Just in summary, 3Q includes the benefits of mindfulness, calm, clarity, and focus, plus the additional benefits of all the other 3Q faculties. Now, just to make a point here, it is useful to make to note this difference, that one of the faculties of spiritual intelligence is ethics, which mindfulness completely lacks. And this is one of the important differences between mindfulness and spiritual intelligence, that, you know, you could rob a bank mindfully, right? You can walk into a bank, pull your gun out, and aim it at the cashier and go, give me your money. And you can do all this mindfully, right? I'm aware of the contents of the mind without judgment. I'm not judging the fact that I'm going to shoot this cashier. I'm not judging that at all. I'm just, you know, observing it without judgment. And you're taking the money. So you can rob a bank with mindfulness, can't you? So there's no ethical dimension there, right? No ethical dimension. So mindfulness is not sufficient in order to generate the transformation that is required for the purpose of a happy life, personal development, or social transformation. It's mindfulness is on its own is a step in the right direction, but it's an incomplete spiritual practice because it does not convert the heart. There's no ethical dimension, you see. You can practice mindfulness as a psychopath and you'll still be a psychopath, right? Whereas you can't practice 3Q as a psychopath, you wouldn't even get past step two, right? So mindfulness is an incomplete transformation. However, it's a good first step, so we must respect it for that. All right, so I think let's leave it there on mindfulness. If you have any further questions on it, we can look at those next time. Bastianella, any other questions that to look at today?
Well, I just want to ask Adrian or Diana, if you have any questions, please type it in the chat box. But I think we're running out of time to cover another question, so we may just leave it for next time, if that's okay.
Sure, okay.
So if Adrian says thank you, so no further questions. From him. Thank
Great.
You for joining us today. Yeah, hopefully we can meet in the next mentoring sessions as well. And please address your questions on email or here in the chat box next time. Thank you for joining us and have a great day.
Yeah, thanks everyone, and bye-bye for now.